Good afternoon and welcome. This is our first lecture on TE1131, which is Introduction to Computers and Programming. So the course will involve the theory about computer hardware and also software development. So in our first lecture, we're going to look at the uses of the computer and a few things about the background on computers so that we can start at the same page when we go into the computer history. And I found it important that we understand what a computer is and everything about computing before we go into the history, so that when we make comparison about the features of the computers, we'll be understanding what we are talking about. Right, so to start our lecture, I'll start by sharing now the presentation which I will use in our lecture. Right, so we are looking at TEE1131. That's the code for the course at NAST. That's Introduction to Computers. That's Introduction to Computer Engineering and Programming. So on this, we will look at the introduction to our first lecture, presented by me, Errol Kunda, lecturer in the Department of Electronic Engineering, and it's NAST in Zimbabwe. So the objectives of this chapter, one, to recognize the importance of computer literacy, two, to define the term computer and identify its components, three, explain a computer and why it is a powerful tool in the world, and describe the categories of computers, then also be able to identify different parts of the computers and also the users and the how computer impacts in the society. So first, explain what is computer literacy. So in English, literacy is the ability to read and write, or also it can mean the competence or knowledge in a specified field. So in this case, when we're talking about computer literacy, we're talking about the knowledge and understanding of computers and their uses. And someone might ask, why do we need to understand all these things? It's because computers are everywhere in this world. Here, I just highlighted about 10 uses of computers in different fields. The first one being education, which I'm using right now for the presentation. Then we use computers in government offices. Then in banking sector and sports, you use computers in the defense and environment. Computers are also used in hospitals and at home, in the medical field and business, and in the development of other technologies. You realize that we still have to use computers. So we're talking about computers. What is a computer? So a computer is the electronic device which operates under the control of instructions. And these instructions are stored in its memory. So what does the computer do in order to operate? First, it accepts data, which is raw facts, and arranged facts. This can be in form of symbols or figures. After that, it processes the data into information. We'll talk about information now. We're talking about data that is organized, that becomes useful and also meaningful. And then the information is produced and stored for future use or for use in other equipments. So that's how our computer will be operating. And so for the computer to be able to do all these things, it should have input devices. And an input device now is any hardware that you use to enter data and the instructions into a computer. In this case, for this lecture, I'm using a keyboard to move my slides. I'm also using a camera to take the video. And on the camera, there's also a microphone, which is also used to take the audio of this computer. So if you look at that large picture, you have a lot of input devices which we can use. And we have the microphone, as I said, the digital camera, also the card reader as input devices. The mouse again is an input device. And the keyboard is also an input device. But also in this picture, we have also shown other devices which are output devices, like the scanner, and the scanner is an input device. But then the speaker is an output device. The printer is also an output device, and also the speaker, so that you can hear what is being said, is also an output device. But also there is an issue of storage devices, which come in the form of CD-ROMs, floppy disks, hard disks, and also the flash drives, which you also use for storage. Then there are also things like the modems, which we use for communication. We also have other data cards that can be used for communication. So basically, that is what you can find on a computer, but you don't find everything on the computer, like I'm saying. You might just find storage, a few input devices and output devices, but still the set will be complete. So what you are looking at, pointed to by the arrows, are the components. And what about the output devices? These are devices that convey information to a user. So you should understand that the computer, it understands information in terms of ones and zeros, like the digital input that it takes. But then for the user to understand what has been processed, then it has to come out as user usable information. And that is the hardware that is used to produce that become the output hardware. So in that case, we're talking about the speakers, because the human being who understands speech, therefore you can use a speaker. Then also printers, you can print and read from a paper. That is also an output device. And talk about the monitor so that you can see what is happening. Like when you watch this video, you'll be looking at your monitor. That's also an output device. Then you also have other things like the speakers, the printers, and so on, which come as our output devices. So an output device is any hardware that conveys information to a user. Then also go to the system unit, which is pointed by the by that red arrow. So this red arrow, it shows the system unit, which people mistakenly say is the CPU, you know, is the system unit. This unit is the box like casing, which contains electronic components used to process data. So you might not find this thing on a laptop computer, because the motherboard is just there and it's flat on the board, but that becomes also its system unit. So let's make that correction. This is not a CPU, it's a system unit that houses and stores the hardware that is used in processing the information. And then what the main components of the computer system. Remember, I said the system unit is a motherboard, which is the circuit board, which holds all the other components used by the computer in processing its information. So the two main components are the CPU, which is the central processing unit, or the processor, which carries out instructions and instructs the computer what to do. Then there's also memory, which is temporary holding space for data and instructions. So this is an Intel Pentium CPU, and this is a memory card that is used in the computer system. So those are the two main components. We'll look at it in detail later, in the later chapters that are to come. Then we also talk about storage. Storage, those are the devices which are used to hold data instructions and information for future use. Then the storage media are the physical material on which data instruction information are stored. Then storage devices records this and retrieves items to and from the storage medium. There's a very thin line between those two. Then the examples of storage devices, we have what are called floppy disks, though these days they are no longer very common. These are flexible and plastic, closed in a rigid plastic shell, right? These were used in the first few generations of computers. They were used in floppy disks. Then there's also the zip disk, which looks like a greater storage. Again, This looks more like, again, a floppy disks. So in general, don't have so many floppy disks now these days. But if you've been watching some movies long back, people would fight for these disks. And you'd find that that will be the floppy disks. And also look at the hard disk, which provides greater storage and housing the system unit. So here I have with me hard disks. This is a laptop hard disk for a Toshiba laptop. So this is a hard disk. This is a laptop hard disk. So for the bigger pieces, just bigger in size, but it looks like the same. If you look at it properly, you realize that there's also some connection slots right there. So this is the hard disk that we are talking about. It has greater storage, and for this one, it's a 500 gig hard drive. Now, when we talk about the hard drive now, it's not memory, as some mistakenly call it. This is storage, and it's not memory. We'll clarify the difference again as we move on. Then there's what is called the CD, which is the compact disk. So CD, it means compact disk. These are flat, round, and portable disks. Some are metal, some are now made of like a plastic, like glass. And then coming in terms of a CD-ROM, when you say CD-ROM, it's just read only. That means you save the information once, and all you can do is now read. Then the CD read and write, that means you can also save information. And also after that, you can also add more information. That is a read and write. Then there's also the DVD, and they also come in terms of the ROM and the read and write. And the DVDs now, they have larger capacity than our CDs. Then there's a miniature storage media, which are smaller these days. You find them in terms of memory cards. These are very small and thin. They're normally used in digital cameras, Android computers, and also in your cell phones. You use those miniature storage media. Fortunately, these days, a lot of us have the chance to use them, either in our phones and other music playing devices. So what makes the computer a powerful tool? The computer is powerful because it has speed. That means it can do many calculations or carry out many instructions per second compared to the human being. It is very reliable. That means once you write a proper program in the computer, it will follow that program religiously. It is also very accurate. That means if you write an accurate program, you don't expect the computer to lose its accuracy. And it also has storage and also the capability to communicate with other devices. That's why you can now access information from one computer over the internet. That means it has also the ability to do communications. Then how does the computer operate? The computer now will operate under the instruction of what we call computer software. That means if you buy a computer and you download the software, then you will not be able to use it. So you need that software in order to use the computer. So the way you put software into a computer is what is called installation. So when I'm saying you're installing a software, I'm saying you're putting the software into the computer. Then when you're using the software, you're now saying you're running the software. You run the software program, then that is what you'll be doing. Then what do we call this software? It's called a software program. And the program becomes a series of instructions that tell the computer what to do. So this is how you can install your software. One, instead the disk and the CD-ROM drive. Now these days you can use other devices which your computer can read. Then you store the program using the instructions that are given. Then you run the program. That is, you are now executing the program. So those are the simple steps that you use to get software into your machine, install it so that it becomes resident and usable on the computer. Then you can run the software. So under the software, normally the software will give you what we call a GUI, the graphical user interface. So the graphical user interface will allow the user to interact with the software using graphics or icons. Then it also controls how you enter data and how the screen will display information. So really that it would be very difficult to use a computer that does not have a graphical user interface. So the graphical user interface will present to you some objects which you can now use to perform different tasks, right? Then there's what is called system software, right? So the system software now is the software which you install first into your computer so that it can control the operation of the computer. So the first and most important system software is what we call the operating systems. And this coordinates the activities of the computer and communication between the computer hardware devices. It also allows you to run the application software. So what you use at a later stage now becomes your application software, but it should be able to sit on an operating system, which is direct control and communication with your computer hardware. Then you also have what are called utility programs. These are now used for you by the user to do maintenance tasks on your computer. And that also helps you to manage the computer. But the most important system software is your operating system. Then application software, these are now made to perform specific tasks. So there are word processing application software, which you can use to type and write to produce documents. There are also spreadsheets applications, which you can use like the Excel. Then there's also database applications, which you can use for developing databases for storing a lot of information. Then there are also presentation graphics like the Microsoft PowerPoint, which I'm using right now. That is an application software. So who produces this software, which is now usable in the computer? We call that person a programmer. So the programmer is the person who develops application or a system software. In other words, when you are a programmer, you should be able to write instruction directly into the computer so that it can process data into information. Then that is the person who we call the programmer. So when we are now talking about programming, like in this course, we talk about programming in C, we'll be trying to make you become our programmer so that you can now develop an application or a system software that can be used. So what are the types of computers that we have? We have the personal computers, the desktops and the laptops, mobile computers and mobile devices. Then the mid-range servers, it's become slightly bigger. Mainframe, now it's bigger than all these normal usable desktop computers. Then we also have supercomputers, which are used for more specific applications. So personal computers, these are the ones we call PCs. So when talking about a PC, we're talking about a personal computer. So these are normally most of them, the most common ones are either Apple or Windows operating system computers. So either in most cases, it's either it runs under Windows operating system from Microsoft, or it comes under Apple, the Mac operating systems. Then the desktop computer, all it means from the English is that it should fit on a desk or on a table. That becomes a desktop computer. Then there's what we call the notebook computer and our laptops. These are the ones which have become smaller enough to fit on someone's sleep. So you can use it while moving around. And they're generally more expensive than the desktop computer, basically because of the portability. So you can use it anyway out of office and the like, because they have their own battery, which can run for several hours before it runs down. Then you also have handheld devices or handheld computers. We have our tablets. Most people might have used them. You can also use them to write on the screen and the like. Then you also have web-enabled handheld computers, which allow you to check your emails, access internet, And these also come in the form of our smartphones, which are very popular these days. Then we also have a PDA, which is a personal digital assistant. These are normally used maybe in businesses, and they provide personal organizing functions. Some call them organizers. Normally you have a calendar, appointment book, address book, a calculator, and a notepad. So really that you are just trying to remove paperwork and diaries from there. You can use that as your personal diary. That's a PDA, which you can use. Then we also look at servers, right? So these servers are now, they are now bigger. They have bigger storage. So the mid-range servers, they are also large, support up to a few thousand computers. And if the mainframe, which is very powerful and expensive, supports thousands of computers. So you find that you may have very few mainframe computers in a country or in a city, because they can support a lot of users. You can look at like the SIM switch to be powered by them, through the mainframe, that it can support a lot of terminals. Then you have the supercomputer, which is the fastest and most powerful and also most expensive. These are used in more complicated mathematical calculations that are used, and some use them in storing the game servers, becoming the game servers, because they are very fast, but they're also very, very expensive. So all we have, when you have a computer, the presence of the computer now allows you to produce what we call an information system. So an information system now involve people, procedures, data, software, and hardware. So in an information system, people will develop the procedures for processing data, and they use the software to enter data into the computer. Then the software processes the data and directs hardware to store and or output the information, and that becomes an information system. So as you can see, the human being is also part of the information systems, because one, you are the one who developed the procedures, you are also the one who enters data for the computer to process and store or use its output. So five categories of computer users now that we have. One, we have home users. So these use computers just at home for personal use. And we also have small office users. Also have the mobile users, which normally use phones and laptops. Then we also have the large businesses or corporates, which also use computers in the what we call the power users. So let's look at in these individually. So what is the software available for a home user? A home user normally needs web access, and also uses a computer for entertainment, communication, and personal finance management. That is what a home user needs. Then the small office user may need a local area network, because they might need to communicate with other people in a company. Also look at productivity software. So special software, web usage, and also emails. So these functions also allow companies to operate, but with people in different locations. Then for a mobile user, they use notebook computers, which are laptops. They use Android computers or web-enabled cell phones. The software normally is productivity, presentation, and personal information management software that are used for our mobile users. So someone can still at least do their work away from office using those devices. Then also there's a large business now. They use web access, maybe public kiosks and telecommunications, networking, productive software, and scheduling. So you look at that as things that are available to large users. So you may find out that a corporate may have a computer center where these things are done. Then also, we look at what we call the power users. So the power users now, they use much speed and storage. And we look at examples like engineers, architects, desktop publishers, and graphic artists. So this one, they use powerful machines because they need speed, they need high storage for whatever they will be working on. So on our part as engineers, you realize that you need this software basically for simulations and processing of data, networking, maybe in the plants and the like. So you will become a power user if you use a computer for such things. Then what are the applications of computers in a society with education, with finance, with the government, healthcare, science, publishing, travel, industry, the environment, you name it. So almost everything now in life, it circles around the computer. That's why most of you now will not be very comfortable when your laptop or your phone goes down. Remember, a phone is also a computer under the mobile devices, because it again uses instructions to perform its functions. So what can we say in conclusion, concluding this first introduction for us? We can just say that computers, they make the world smaller, smarter, and more organized. They make the world smaller because of the internet. You can talk to people who are thousands of miles away. You can actually do meetings and the like, and that makes the world smaller. To make the world smarter, because you can organize a lot of things, and then the computer can take over and also assist you. And also become more organized, because you can schedule whatever you want to schedule using the computer. So this marks the end of our lecture for the introduction. Then I hope you also go to the YouTube channel and to watch this video so that we can proceed. Thank you so much.